Good morning and happy Sabbath. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you that I have life. I thank you that every person seated before me has life. Father, I praise you and I give you glory and honor. I don't give it to you as you ought to receive it, Father. I cannot do that. But Lord, I praise you and I thank you for the Sabbath. And I thank you that we know about the Sabbath. I thank you that we have knowledge of Scripture. I thank you that there is a guardian angel that walks with each and every one of us. I thank you for the angels in this room this morning. Father, I thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Father, I thank you for what you will do in this place today. I praise you for the lives that will be touched. And I praise you for the glory and honor that you will receive. In Jesus' name I plead, have mercy upon me and have mercy upon these people who are seated before me. In Jesus' name I pray that devils may be bound in Jesus' name. This is my prayer, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The title of today's message is Almost Christian. Almost Christian. Three things before we begin that I must share with you. Matthew 18, verse 20. Very famous verse, very known verse, where Jesus says, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them." Jesus does not say, "Where two or three are gathered together, I am there in the midst of them." What Jesus says is, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst with them." If I come to this place and my preaching is to reveal the knowledge that I have of Christ, Jesus is not with me. If the reason why I preach is not to exalt Christ and to first of all lead me closer to Christ, then it is in vain. And if we come to this place, and the reason why we are in this place is not to seek God, it is not to come in His name, then He's not with us. But when we come because we want God, when we come because we want to have a divine encounter with Him, it is impossible for God not to come down and there will be a revival. The number one hindrance to revival is that we don't want God. We want what God can give us. We don't go to God because we want Him, because we love Him. We go to God because we want blessings. We want protection. We want things from Him and not God. In the beginning, we were with God. Sin separated us from God. And Jesus has come to restore us back to God. That's it. It is a relationship with God. And if we come to this place and our objective is not God, it is not to seek God and to spend time with God, to know God, then it is in vain. We can preach a nice sermon, we can sing beautiful songs with our beautiful voices, but if it is not to seek God and to be with God and for the glory of God, all of this is a waste of time and it is in vain. So we have come here in Jesus' name. Second thing is this message that God has for us today is not for your roommate, it is not for your neighbor, it is not for your classmate, it's not for your boyfriend or girlfriend or husband and wife, but this message is for you. Often we come to church and we listen to a sermon and we say, "Oh, only if my friend was here. Only if my church members were here. Only if so and so." No, no, no. This message is for you. It's not for those who are not here. They should have been here, but they are not here. So this is for you. And we pray that God may speak to them either wherever they are or that God may spare them so that one day He can speak to them. Third thing. We are going to take a flight. This place will be the body of the plane. Our co-pilot is the Holy Spirit. the guide. He's our co-pilot. Our fuel will be faith. God is the control tower. I'm just the voice of the plane. You can forget about me. I'm not important. God is the control center, and our destination is at Jesus' feet. This flight will take up to 40 or 45 minutes. But before we take off, I need you to put your cell phones on flight mode. We don't want to experience any turbulence. So please, I plead with you, put your cell phones on flight mode. I plead with you so that we don't experience any turbulence. I'll give you 5 seconds for that. And if you've done that already, come with me to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26. The title of the sermon is Almost Christian. Almost Christian. And the title of the sermon comes from verse 27. The Bible's verse 28, sorry. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "You almost means what we are about to read did not really happen. It almost happened. You almost persuade me to become a what? A Christian. Almost Christian. A Christian is a follower of Christ. A Christian is someone who speaks Christ-like, dresses Christ-like, behaves Christ-like. And being a Christian is the solution to the world because Jesus is the solution to the world. There are many people today who are afraid of many things. In the Philippines, people are afraid of typhoons. People are afraid of tsunamis. People are afraid of earthquakes. Some people are afraid of a financial crisis. Some people are afraid of a famine. The worst thing that can happen to the world is not a financial crisis, is not an earthquake, it is not a calamity or a disaster. The worst thing that can happen to a person is not to face a financial problem. The worst thing you can face is facing a financial problem without Jesus. It is to encounter an earthquake and not be in Christ. Because if you die, you're going to heaven. So the worst thing that can happen to you is not to die. That is, if you have died without Christ, then it's the worst thing that can happen to you. But if you have Jesus, even if you die in that earthquake, it's not the end. And if you have Jesus, he will provide for you and he will keep you. Here you have Paul, an amazing man, a man filled with the Holy Spirit. He gives a wonderful testimony. His testimony was true. His testimony was led by the Holy Spirit. Every person in that room was convicted. And this man says, "You almost persuade me to become a Christian. It is not that I did not understand your message. It's not that I don't believe your message." Come with me, same chapter. Paul here is giving his testimony, and I want you to begin with me in verse 11. Paul says, "And I punished them." He's talking about Christians. Paul was a man with a strange mission. Paul's mission was to find people, not ordinary people, people who were filled with the Holy Spirit, and to kill them. He was persecuting the people of God. That's what he was doing. And in verse 11 says, "And I punished them, often in every synagogue, and compelled them to blaspheme. And being exceedingly enraged against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities." Not only was he persecuting men, but even women. He used to throw them into prison. Verse 12, "While thus occupied, as I journeyed to Damascus with authority and commission from" who? The chief priests. It was the church that had commissioned him. This is amazing. And given him authority to kill Christians. The chief priest was the one who sent him. Where are we? 13. At midday, O king, along the road, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining around me and those who journeyed with me. 14. And when we all had fallen to the ground, all of them fell to the ground. All of them saw this light. I heard a voice speaking to me and saying in the Hebrew language, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. Verse 15. So I said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am who? Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Jesus spoke Hebrew. In verse 14, he says that the voice or the person who spoke to him spoke in what language?
Hebrew.
In Hebrew. Saul, why are you persecuting me? Jesus by then was no longer on earth. Jesus was in heaven. What is Jesus saying? Why are you persecuting me? Who was he really persecuting? He was going after Christians. But Jesus tells him, you are actually persecuting me. Verse 16. But arise and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you. This is amazing. For this purpose, to make you a what? A minister and a witness, both of the things which you have seen and of the things which I will yet reveal to you. Here you have a murderer. A man who is running after the elect of God to kill them. In fact, what he's going to do right now is he's going to destroy Christians. And Jesus comes to him and tells him, I have chosen you. I will make you a minister and you will be my witness of the things that you have seen, and I will still show you many things, and you must go preach the gospel. A murderer. God goes to him and tells him, I have chosen you. Paul says, God has chosen the foolish things of the world to embarrass the wise. He has chosen the weak things to embarrass the strong. Verse 17, I will deliver you from the Jewish people. In other words, Jesus is telling him, I have chosen you and I will send you to preach the gospel. And what will happen is that you will be persecuted. This is why he tells him, I will protect you. And from the Jewish, not from the Gentiles, he does not mention that, but he says, I will deliver you from the Jewish. In other words, your own people will persecute you. As well as from the Gentiles to whom I now send you. What is God sending him to do? Verse 18. To open their eyes. Every person that does not have Christ is blind. Though they walk, though they talk, they are dead and they have no life. And it says, in order to turn them from darkness to what? To light. That they may receive... And from the power of Satan to the power of who? Every person that is unconverted is under the power of the devil. From the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. And Paul continues. And then he talks about Jesus' resurrection. And by the time he's talking about Jesus' resurrection, in verse 24, the Bible says this, now as he thus made his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, in other words, he interrupted Paul, and he shouted and said, Paul, you are beside yourself. Much learning is driving you mad. He says, Paul, you are crazy. You are out of your mind. And if you go to the book of John, chapter 10, verse 20, it says that they said to Jesus, "You have a demon and you are mad." And if you go in John 7, they also accused Jesus of having a demon and being mad. And here Paul is preaching the gospel, and he tells them that Jesus came and Jesus lived, Jesus resurrected, Jesus ascended into heaven, and Jesus has called me to preach the gospel. They listened to him and they said, "You are mad." In other words, you are crazy. And in John 7, the Bible says that even Jesus' disciples did not believe in him. You go down to verse 25. "But he said, 'I am not mad, most noble Festus.'" I love this. "Though they are accusing him of being mad, and he knows he's not mad, and he knows what he's saying is the truth, he does not seem to be... It seems that he controls himself. He's composed. "For the king, before whom I also speak freely," this is verse 26, "knows these things. For I am convinced that none of these things escapes his attention. Since this thing was not done in a what? In a corner." Verse 27. "King Agrippa," this is Paul speaking to him, "do you believe the prophets?" And Paul doesn't wait for him to answer. And I don't think he asked this question expecting him to answer. Paul says, "I know that you do believe." Verse 28. "Then Agrippa said to Paul, 'You almost persuade me to become a Christian.'" I don't know how you feel when you read this. Here you have this man who believes. He has heard the truth. He knows the word. But he refuses to surrender to Christ. He says, "Almost." And Paul tells him, "I know you believe the prophets. I know you know that what I'm saying is the truth, that I am not lying." I want to invite you to Acts 17 as we take off. Perhaps it's best if we go to Acts 4. Come with me to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4, verse 12 to verse 14. And then we'll go to Acts 11. Verse 12 says, "Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be" what? "Which we must be saved." The only way for us to be saved is through Jesus Christ. Now let me tell you something. Almost every person in the world has heard this. Almost every person in the world has heard of Christ. But the world today is largely unconverted. The world today is mad. Verse 13. "Now when they saw" the what? "The courage" or the boldness of who? "Of Peter and John, and perceived," they noticed, "that they were" what? "Uneducated and untrained men, they marveled." And they realized that they had been with who? Let me help you understand this verse. When they looked at Peter and John, the Bible says they noticed that they were bold, and they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained. And they marveled. Why did they marvel? Because although they were uneducated, they spoke as though they were educated. Although they were untrained, they conducted themselves as though they were trained. And so they marveled, and even when they saw their boldness, and this is what happened when they saw this. If you continue to read, the end of the verse says, "And they realized that they had been with" who? "Jesus." In other words, this is what happened. When they saw the life of Peter, when they saw the life of John, when they saw how they conducted themselves, when they saw how they spoke, how they behaved, it brought a memory It stirred something in them. It made them remember of someone. Haven't you ever looked at someone and they remind you of another person? You look at them and sometimes you cannot get it right away, but you keep analyzing them. And you keep saying, wait a minute, have I seen this person or have I seen someone like this person? The Bible says they marveled and then they realized that they had been with Jesus. As they looked at Peter, as they looked at John, it made those people remember that once there was a man in Jerusalem like them. So they said, these men must have been with Jesus. If people look at you today, if people observe your lives, can people say that you have been with Jesus? Acts 11, verse 26. Paul now has been converted, and Barnabas goes to fetch him. Look at verse 25. Acts 11, 25. Then Barnabas departed for Tarsus to seek who? To seek Saul. He went to look for Saul so that they could go minister together in Antioch. Verse 26. And when he had found him, when he found Paul, he brought him to where? To Antioch. So it was that for a whole year, they assembled with the church and taught a great many people. And the disciples were first called what? Where? The title of the sermon is Almost Christian. The Bible says that the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. Many of us call ourselves Christians. Did you know that this is where you got the name from? It was given by the people who lived in Antioch. This is what happened. The people in Antioch were known for giving nicknames. But the way they gave nicknames is not as the world today gives nicknames. When Paul and Barnabas went to Antioch, the people noticed that whenever they spoke, they kept mentioning a name, and that was Christ. They noticed that they only spoke about Christ. They noticed that they behaved about the Christ whom they spoke about. They noticed that they were Christ-centered. So as they observed them, they nicknamed them Christians, which means followers of who? Of Christ. And that is how they got that nickname. And that is why we are called Christians, because Paul and Barnabas went to Antioch and all they did was Christ-centered, so they called them followers of Christ. If people today were to observe your life, if people today were to take your laptop, if we were to look at what you spend your time the most doing and looking at, can we say that you are a follower of Christ? Can people nickname you a follower of Christ based on what you talk the most about, based on what you see, based on what you do, based on how you dress? Are you a Christian or are you almost a Christian? This is very serious. Judas walked with Jesus for 3.5 years. Matthew chapter 10 says that Judas received authority over all unclean spirit. Judas cast out demons. Judas was sent out when Jesus sent out all the disciples. And Judas was among them when they came back and said, even demons obey your name. But Judas is going to hell. Balaam was a prophet. God spoke through him. But Balaam is going to hell. He knew about Jesus. He knew about Christ. But he had not surrendered fully. You remember the demon-possessed man who came to Jesus and said, have you come to torment us before the appointed time? Demons know that there is an appointed time. And the demon said, Son of the Most High God. demons know who Jesus is. They know that he is the Son of God. They know. Let me tell you, the devil knows the whole Bible. He knows the whole Bible more than we do. But that knowledge will not save him. He refused to submit to God in heaven. A knowledge of Scripture will not save you. Quoting Scripture does not mean that will get you to heaven. I want you to come with me to Acts 17. I believe that today in the world, not everyone that professes to be a Christian is a Christian. I believe that the majority is almost Christian. Like this king who heard the gospel, knows the gospel, he can quote the gospel, they can even preach the gospel, but they are not filled with the Spirit of God. And if you come with me to Acts chapter 17, I want you to come immediately to verse 2. The Bible says, then Paul, as his what? Custom was, went into them and for three Sabbaths reasoned with them from the what? From the Scriptures. This immediately reminds me of Luke 4:16, talking about Jesus says, and as his custom was, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up forth to what? To read. Same thing, it was Jesus' custom to go to church on the Sabbath. It was also Paul's custom, according to Acts 17:2, to go to church on the Sabbath. A custom is a culture, it is a way of life, it is a habit. This means that when Jesus was on earth, he went to church every Sabbath. This means that Jesus kept every Sabbath, Paul kept every Sabbath. And I'm sure Jesus did not go late to church on the Sabbath. I am sure that Paul did not go late to church on the Sabbath. And it says that as it was his custom, he went to the place where he had been brought up, and he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood forth to read. And Acts 17:2 says that Paul reasoned with them from the Scriptures. Both of them were going to church to be with God. Verse 3, explaining, this is what Paul was doing in the church, and demonstrating that the Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead, and saying, this Jesus, whom I preach to you, is the what? The Christ. Verse 5, but the Jews who were not persuaded, becoming what? Envious, becoming jealous of Paul, took some evil men from the what? The marketplace, and gathering a mob, set all the city in what? In an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason and sought to bring them out to the people. As there was a revival going on, because Paul was preaching Christ and was leading people to Scripture, some Jews became jealous. And by the way, persecution doesn't only come from the Gentiles, but it also comes from within the church. Paul was sent, we read, to kill Christians. He was commissioned and authorized by the chief, what? By the priest. Here you have Paul preaching the gospel. There's a revival. And the persecution is not coming from the Gentiles, but it's coming from the fellow Jews. They are jealous because God is with Paul. And so they went to the marketplace and they gathered a mob. What they would usually do is they would pay those people, they would take them to the church, and they would tell them to cause an uproar, to cause confusion, to bring division. And that is what the devil is doing in these last days. There are people that have entered the church to destroy and to cause division. They bring strange debates. They bring strange topics. And in these last days, as we are supposed to preach the gospel, we are supposed to focus on having a relationship with Christ. We are supposed to focus on knowing Jesus more. We are spending our times arguing with one another things that do not save us and do not advance the gospel. And the same thing happens here. And if you go to verse 6, the Bible says, but when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some brethren to the rulers of the city, crying out, these who have turned the world upside down have come here too. Why are Christians today not turning the world upside down? Do we not pray to the same God? Do we not call upon the same Spirit? Do we not still worship on the same day? Why is the world not being turned upside down? If you go to John 12:19, it says that Jesus, because of Jesus, Jerusalem was in an uproar and the world was going after him. The Pharisees were complaining. In John 15, verse 18, Jesus says, if they persecuted me, they would persecute you. And in verse 20, Jesus says, a servant is not greater than his master. If they accepted my word, they will accept your word. They rejected my word, so they will also reject your word. The reason why the world is not being turned upside down is because many who profess to be Christians are not genuinely converted. They are almost Christians. The moment we take scripture and apply scripture, the moment we follow Christ, my friends, the devil will come after us. And the reason why he doesn't come after us is because the majority of us are actually with the devil. This is why he does not disturb us, because we are with him. But the moment we start to leave him, that's when he disturbs you. Why must he persecute you? Why must he disturb you when you are with him? The moment we genuinely start seeking after God, he's going to come after us. But even that is not a problem. Paul says that I am convinced that what? Neither angels nor demons nor height nor depth nor anything present nor anything to come shall ever separate me from the love of God. Paul says I'm here today and there is absolutely nothing, no temptation, no trial, no difficulty that the devil can bring to me today and I will abandon Christ. And there's nothing he can bring tomorrow. There's nothing he can do next year. There's absolutely nothing in this world that the devil can think of or do that will separate me from the love of God. Can you say that? My friends, the problem is not tribulation. It is not the persecution. It is not the difficulty. It is not the hypocrisy. The problem is that we do not have Christ. Because once you truly have Christ, there is absolutely nothing that can keep you from the kingdom of heaven. This is amazing. Paul says, today, as I stand here, there's nothing he can do today that will lead me from being in heaven with God. And even if he comes tomorrow, there's also nothing he can do to me. And if you go to Philippians, he mentions that I am stuck between the two. If I die, Paul says, I'm saved. He says, if I die, I know that when Jesus comes, I'm going to heaven. If I die now. And then Paul says, but I'm caught between the two. Because I want to stay for the brethren. And he mentions this, that even if I stay and I do not die, while I'm alive, there's nothing the devil can do to prevent me from being with God in heaven. And Paul here has to flee from this place. And if you come with me to verse 10, the Bible says, then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. When they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. I don't know if you've noticed, but Paul never stayed in a town for very long. He was always on the move. He was not too popular wherever he went. He was not too famous. He always had to flee. Paul says, I was stoned times without number. Now, Paul was not seeking persecution. And I'm not telling you that you must go and seek persecution. What I'm telling you is that it comes as a result of knowing Jesus and walking with Jesus. Our goal is not to preach. Our goal is not to sing to others. Singing, preaching, and ministering is a result of having a genuine relationship with Christ. It comes out of that. It is a result. It is not a goal. Our goal is to be with Christ. Our goal is to seek Christ, to know Him, and to have a relationship with Him. So he had to flee from this place. Verse 11, the Bible says that these were more what? More noble-minded or more fair-minded than those in where? Thessalonica. Meaning this group of Christians were different. They were more fair-minded than the rest. Why is that? The Bible says, in that they received the word with all what? Readiness. All readiness. My dear friends, a Seventh-day Adventist is not someone who only goes to church on the Sabbath. A Seventh-day Adventist is not someone who only goes to church on Wednesday or on Vespers. It is not someone who only reads their Bible on the Sabbath or in church. A Seventh-day Adventist is somebody who has been reading the Bible throughout the whole week. And when they come to church on the Sabbath, they don't come to church hungry of the word. They just come to church to get more of the word. A Seventh-day Adventist is not going to church hungry or empty of the Holy Spirit. He may go to church hungry because he wants more, but he's not going to church empty. He's going to church to get more of the Holy Spirit because he already got it during the week. He doesn't only read his Bible in church. He has devotionals, or she, throughout the week. They already have worshiped Sunday to Friday. And Saturday, they just come to do it as brethren, to do it together. And it says that they were more fair-minded because they received the word with all readiness. And the Bible says, and searched the scriptures daily. Every day they would search the scriptures. Every day they spend time reading the Bible. You know, there are Bibles today in some homes where you could write your name on the cover because there's so much dust on those Bibles. It says they read the word daily. They searched the scriptures to find out whether these things were so. When they heard Paul preaching, they took the scriptures and they analyzed what Paul was saying, if whether what he was saying was in accordance with the word of God. And they analyzed it. If what Paul was saying was true, they followed it. But if what he was saying was not in scripture, they would not follow it. So they were Bible-based people. They did not require a thus says a philosopher or a pastor or a preacher. They required a thus saith the Lord. And the devil hates this. The devil despises this. And proof of that is what happens in verse 12. The Bible says, therefore, many of them what? Believed. And also not a few of the Greeks, prominent women as well as men. There was a revival. And if you go to verse 13, the Bible says, but when the Jews from Thessalonica learned that the word of who? Word of God, not the word of the preacher or of a philosopher, but the word of God was preached by Paul at Berea, they came there also and stirred up the crowds. This was the mob that had stirred out the crowd when they were in Thessalonica. Paul left because of them. And he goes to this place. He's preaching the word. There's a revival. They hear that the word is being preached there. So they follow Paul there and they cause another uproar. And by the way, these are Jews. These are fellow Seventh-day Adventists. And the devil is doing the same in these last days. And as we are being revived by his word, the devil seeks to cause division. Instead of us focusing on Jesus Christ, we focus on one another, seeking for each other's faults. Verse 14, then immediately the brethren sent Paul away to go to the sea, but both Silas and Timothy remained there. Now Paul has to leave again this place because of what he's preaching. And if you go to verse 16, the Bible says, now while Paul waited for them at Athens, we need to stop here. What was Paul doing in Athens? Are you sure? Verse 16. Now while Paul, what? Waited for them at Athens. Paul was not going there to preach yet. Paul was waiting. But it did not last long. Why didn't it last long? Continue to read the verse. His spirit was provoked. Other version says it was stirred, or he became angry. What made him angry? He was angry within when he saw that the city was given over to what? To idols. Paul was there waiting for Silas and Timothy. And as he was waiting for them, he saw that the city was given to idol worship. So his spirit was stirred, and as a result, he began to preach in Athens. How do you feel when you see people today bowing down to statues, praying to things that cannot move and cannot talk? And many who do this call themselves Christians. They are deceived, misled that they are Christians. They are bowing down to... How do you feel when you see these things? The Bible says that Paul's spirit was stirred within him. They were worshiping idols. There are many who do this today. They are fooled and deceived, unfortunately, that they are Christians. Paul did not keep quiet. You go to verse 17. The Bible says, therefore, he reasoned in the synagogue. Meaning, because of what he saw, he began to preach with the Jews and with the Gentile, what? Worshippers. And in the marketplace daily with those who happened to be there, he began to preach. And I want you to come in verse 20. Paul says, for the people said this to Paul, for you are bringing some strange things to our ears. Therefore, we want to know what these things, what? Mean. Verse 21, for all the Athenians and the foreigners who were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear what? Something new. Come with me to verse 22. Then Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. For as I was passing through and considering the object of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, him I proclaim to you. And if you continue to read, Paul says he is the one who created the world. And that he lives. He's not dead. He is the true God. This God whom you call the unknown God, he's the true God. He is the only God you should worship. You should not worship idols. You should not bow down to idols. Is this new in scripture? Quickly, come with me to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Just after Numbers. Chapter 4. Fifth book of the Bible. Chapter 4, I want you to come with me to verse 19. The Bible says, and take heed, lest you lift up your eyes to where? To heaven. In other words, be careful. Don't do this. Lest you lift up your eyes to heaven, and when you see the what?
Sun.
The sun, the what?
Moon.
The moon and the stars, all the hosts of heaven, you feel driven
to worship them and serve them, which the Lord your God has given to all the peoples under the whole what? Heaven. So in other words, the Israelites were being warned not to worship the sun, the stars, the moons, and any of the hosts of where? Of heaven. I want you to come with me to Exodus 20. Exodus 20. I want you to look at verse 2. Now these are the Ten Commandments. Some say that the Ten Commandments were abolished. That when Jesus resurrected, Jesus abolished them. Before I get into this, we read in Acts 17 verse 2, the Bible says that it was Paul's custom. Paul went to church on the Sabbath and he did what? He reasoned with them and shared the scripture with them. It was Paul's custom to go to church on the Sabbath. Paul kept the Sabbath. That's in the New Testament. Some say we should not, the Ten Commandments is in the Old Testament. God has a new covenant. He has a new commandment that we should follow. And we don't have to keep the Sabbath anymore. It was abolished. But here you have Paul in the New Testament keeping the Sabbath. Paul was called into the ministry after Jesus' resurrection. He was called when Jesus was already in heaven. He said he heard a voice from heaven, and that voice from heaven called him to minister. Paul here is a converted man filled with the Holy Spirit, commissioned by Jesus himself. He's keeping the Sabbath. Exodus 20, verse 2. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall make for yourselves no carved image of any likeness way in heaven or on earth or the ground or even under the ground or even in the waters. In other words, God says you must not make a statue of anything in heaven, on earth, or even in the water. Now, who is in heaven? What do you find in heaven? God is in heaven. Jesus is in heaven. The angels are in heaven. Elijah is in heaven. Moses is in heaven. Enoch is in heaven. There are people who resurrected when Jesus resurrected on earth that went with him in heaven. Jesus is saying, don't even make a statue of me and bow down to it. And then he says, of any beast, any animal, anything, and of anything in the ocean, you must not make any statue and bow down to it. This is what God is saying. My dear friends, there are many who do these things and they believe that they are Christians. The word of God clearly condemns this. Paul himself went to Athens and rebuked this. I will read one more text and I will say something which may sound very radical, but it is the truth. I want you to come with me to Corinthians. Let me see if it is 2nd. Is it 2nd Corinthians? No. It is in 1st John chapter 5. 1st John chapter 5, verse 21. 1st John? Yes, 1st John chapter 5, verse 21. John here is speaking. And at the end of this epistle, John says, little children, keep yourselves from what? Keep yourselves from what? From idols. It is very clear. This is now Old Testament. We read it this is New Testament now. We read it in the Old Testament. Now we're reading it where? In the New Testament. It continues. The Ten Commandments have not been abolished. What has been abolished is the ceremonial law that pointed to Jesus' death and resurrection as the Lamb of God. And he says, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Every person that bows down to idols is disobeying the word of God. Every religion and every church that bows down to idols is not God's church. Then you go to the fourth commandment. Luke 4:16, Acts 17:2. Paul himself kept the Sabbath. Jesus kept the Sabbath. Matthew 5:17. I have not come to abolish the laws or the prophets, but I have come to what? To fulfill them. This is disturbing. This is stirring. Because the majority who profess to be Christians are bowing down to idols and they do not keep the Sabbath. My dear friends, if you want to find the right church, did you know there are some who go to church on the Sabbath? They profess to be Seventh-day Adventists, but they are not sure whether this is God's church. I say this without any hesitation. The Seventh-day Adventist church is God's church. The Seventh-day Adventist church is God's church. Clearly, we must still keep the Sabbath. Not because we are saved by the Sabbath. Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So we keep his commandments because we know him. It's all about Jesus. It's about having a relationship with him. Because we love him, we keep his commandments. Keeping the commandments is a result of knowing Jesus. Is a result of loving Jesus. And then Jesus says, if you are my friend, you will obey me. Huh? So we keep the commandments because we love Jesus. It is a result of knowing who? Of knowing Jesus. And Jesus says we should not bow down to idols. If you want to know, narrow it down. I'm going to help you quickly. For example, the Bible condemns us worshiping, bowing down to idols. Clearly, any church that does this and encourages people to do this cannot be God's church. If you just take this, many churches are disqualified already. The number is very few. One more thing. The Sabbath remains. Hebrews chapter 4. And Jesus kept the Sabbath. Paul, who was called by Jesus himself, kept the Sabbath. Any church that does not keep the Sabbath and teach that we should keep the Sabbath and that the Sabbath has not been abolished is not from God. My dear friends, you narrow it down. I say it boldly. It is the Seventh-day Adventist church that is God's church on earth. Here's another thing. Unfortunately, now the number has become smaller. Unfortunately, not everyone inside the Seventh-day Adventist Church, not everyone who professes to be a follower of Christ is truly a follower of Christ. Now we got an even smaller number. I don't know how you feel when you read verses that reveal these things to us. I don't know how you feel when you see people who are worshiping on the wrong day, people praying to statues. God says they cannot move, they cannot talk. We know this truth, but we do not share it. As we close, I want to invite you. I want us to go back to Acts. Acts 26. And verse 28. Our key text. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "You almost persuade me to become a Christian." And in verse 29, the Bible says, "And Paul said, I would to God that not only you, but all who hear me today might become both almost and altogether, listen to this, such as I am." Such as I am. Paul says, I don't only desire that you become a Christian, but I desire that the world becomes a Christian. But I like how he puts it. He says, I desire that the world becomes like me. That's what he says. I desire that you become as I am, a follower of Christ. Except for these chains. Verse 30. When he had said these things, the king stood up as well as the governor and Bernice and those who sat with him. Verse 31, and when they had gone aside, they talked among themselves, saying, this man is doing nothing deserving of what? Of death or chains. In other words, they knew that Paul was right. As today, you know that what I'm teaching is right. You know that this does not come from me. I'm not this intelligent. I'm not this bright. You know that God is speaking. You know that this is God's word. You know that this is the truth. Then Agrippa said to Festus, this man might have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. We are living in the last days. I never thought I would live to see what I see today in the world. When I was converted and I understood scripture and I began to walk with Jesus, to talk with Jesus, and I saw the world as God sees the world, I thought I would not live to see what I see today. My dear friends, we are running out of time. We are running out of time. The solution to the world is Christ, but we cannot give this solution if we don't have Jesus within us. I was about to close, but I believe the Holy Spirit wants me to share Acts 19. Come with me to Acts 19. Verse 1, and it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus and finding some what? Some disciples. Who are disciples? Followers of Christ. A Christian is also a what? So these are people who profess to be followers of who? They profess to be Christians. Paul went to Ephesus and he found them there. Verse 2. And he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? This is very strange. Very, very strange. Here is Paul in Ephesus. He finds disciples. And Paul himself knew that they were disciples. Why does Paul ask them if they have the Holy Spirit? Why does he ask them if they have the... It's almost offensive. These are disciples. He knows they're disciples. And if they're disciples, they're Christians, they're followers of Christ, of course, they're supposed to have the Holy Spirit. Look at their answer in verse 2. So they said to him, this is to Paul, we have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit. I will be honest with you. When I read this, I almost cried. I almost cried. They said, we have not even heard of the disciples. These, by the way, are preachers. And this gets more serious. You go to verse 3, and he said to them, into what then were you baptized? So they said, into John's what? They were baptized by John the Baptist? And they don't have the Holy Spirit? Look at what Paul says in verse 4. Then Paul said, John indeed baptized with the baptism of what? Repentance. Saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is on who? They said that they were baptized by John the Baptist. And they said also that they have never heard of the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you something. I don't believe what they said. Because if you go to Matthew 2, verse 11, it says this, that John said, there is one who is coming who is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not fit to untie. He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. John the Baptist preached about the Holy Spirit. Here you are. After these years, they don't have the Holy Spirit. Why is this stirring? Is this to me? John the Baptist began preaching before Jesus. Is that not true? He came to prepare the way for Christ. John baptized them. They were baptized by John. When John died, they continued preaching, these disciples. Jesus continued his ministry and died. In fact, they began to preach before Jesus. And then Jesus ascends and calls Paul to preach. And Paul begins to preach. And later in Paul's ministry, he meets them in Ephesus. By now, Paul had been preaching for years. And these men began before Paul. But they don't have the Holy Spirit. Could it be that you have been going to church? I want to ask you a question. And I want you to analyze yourself. Don't be too quick to answer. Can you say that you have the Holy Spirit? Are you really filled with... This is something very... Let's not just go over this like this. These people have been ministering. They don't have the Holy Spirit. For all these years, disciples, they do not have the Holy Spirit. When you come to this place, whenever you come and gather here, do you honestly feel the presence of God? Do you feel the Holy Spirit within you? Verse 6. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Verse 7. Now the men were about 12 in what? Could it be that we have been almost Christians? These men were almost Christians. They were not Christians. They knew. They were dipped. There are two baptisms. Immersion. And by the way, the only baptism that is recognized in heaven is the baptism by immersion. Any person who has been thrown with water, that's not baptism. Real baptism is by immersion. The Greek word for baptism is baptisto, which means what?
Immerse.
To immerse, to dip, to dip. Any person who is not baptized by immersion has not been baptized. You know what this means? This means that, that people who are going around today believing that they are baptized, believing that they are Christians, believing that when Jesus comes, they will go to heaven. Actually, they are deceived. And my friends, we know this truth, and we sit here, we keep quiet. We don't share it with the world. This is very disturbing, and this is very scary. I would like for you to analyze yourself this morning. Do not be in a hurry to leave this place. But are you truly filled with the Holy Spirit? Are you really saved? Are you really a follower of Christ? If you die today, when Jesus comes, will you really go to heaven? Some people say, oh, I don't know. Well, who knows the future? But Paul says, nor demons, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, that's the future, will separate me from the love of God. I will tell you something. I'm going to heaven. I'm going to heaven and I will be with God, me. I don't know about you. But I'm going there, not because I'm going to do it out of my own strength. I'm going to go there because I'm going to depend on Jesus. Because the Bible says, he who began a work in you will finish it. And I believe that. And it says that he's faithful and just. I believe that he can take me to heaven. And I'm going there. I'm going there. But I don't know about you. I don't know about you. My dear friends, analyze your life. It's your choice. You can be there if you accept Jesus. Just make sure you're reading your Bible every day. You're praying every day. And the reason why you're reading is not to tell people that you have read, but you are reading because you need to get closer to God. You are praying because you want to spend time with God. You want to be with God. You are not coming to church to be seen of people. But you are coming to church because you want to be with God. And I believe that when you do that, there is absolutely nothing that can keep you from the kingdom of heaven. I believe that with all my heart. And these last days, what the devil seeks to do is to keep us away from the word of God. And that is what he's trying to do to the church right now. It is to keep us away from the word of God. Things are going to get worse. There will be more calamities. Unfortunately, there will be more false doctrines. The devil is going to bring strange debates so that we can argue with each other instead of finding ways to build up each other's faith. But I guarantee you this, that though things on earth will get worse, there is one thing that may get better, and that is our faith. In fact, let me tell you, that's the only thing that will get better, that can be better, that can grow. That's our faith. The world will continue to be as it is. In fact, Jesus says it will become worse. Calamities will come. Wars and famine. Earthquakes, they will come. It will become worse. The only thing that can become better is our faith. And once you have Jesus in the midst of all these things, Jesus will preserve you. Jesus will keep you. And even if you die, you're going to be in heaven. And people ask themselves, until when should we wait? Until you receive the Holy Spirit. Until you receive the Holy Spirit. That's it. I want to invite you to pray with me. I want to invite you to bow your heads as we pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit and for the angels. Father in heaven, this is not the first time we have heard your word. And these things are not new to us. Father, please be merciful towards us. Convict us and set us free from self, from pride, from anger, from grudge, from jealousy, from hatred. Set us free from everything and anything that hinders us from having a relationship with you. Father, there are some who stop reading their Bibles. There are some who stop going to church. There are some who don't pray anymore. In Jesus' name, I plead with you that you may give them strength through your Holy Spirit to get closer to Jesus Christ. I pray for any person in this room whose spiritual life has declined. They don't pray like before. They don't read like before. I plead with you that, Father, you may speak to them and you may give them strength to continue. I pray for those that might have physical, might have problems at home, in the family. The devil is causing division in the home. Some might have financial problems. Some are being gossiped about. Father, some even have thoughts of suicide. Some may be believing that their sins cannot be forgiven. Some believe that they have gone too far. That's not true. In Jesus' name, I pray, Father, that you may comfort them, that you may fill them with your Spirit, that you may give them strength to do what is right. Father, I pray that the plans of the devil against every person in this room, in Jesus' name, may be bound. I pray that you may give us a blessed Sabbath, that we may continue to keep it holy as you have instructed us. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.